We would like to dedicate this episode of Skywalking Through Neverland to the memory of Charlie Lippincott, who just passed away on May the 19th. This episode is all about the publicity of The Empire Strikes Back, which Mr. Lippincott worked as the Senior Vice President of Advertising, Publicity, Promotion, and Merchandising. He was definitely a pioneer and mastermind on how films are brought to our attention, and in the case of Star Wars, it was mainly through comics, toys, and merchandise. If there was a Mount Rushmore for the secret sauce of Star Wars, Charlie Lippincott would definitely have a place there. May the Force be with you, Charlie, and thank you for everything. The following feature presentation is part of the Skywalking Network.
This is what you can look forward to on episode 290 of Skywalking Through Neverland.
I was the guy at Lucasfilm when anyone had a question about what was the name of this or how did we do that.
Oh, wow. It's so fun to hear them, though. And yeah, Harrison Ford was like super into it.
It gets real confusing after a while, doesn't it? But basically, this is the second of three films.
The all-night vigil ends Wednesday morning at 11 when these people finally get to buy tickets to the first showing of The Empire Strikes Back.
Okay, so who's with me? Should May be called May the Forceuary? Come on, who's with me on this?
Excuse me, Master Luke, but what is this strange world we've come to?
Beats me, 3PO. Seems we've landed on some sort of comedy variety show planet.
Are you ready?
Welcome to Neverland.
Here we go.
A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome. Disneyland is your land.
When I first made Star Wars, everybody in Hollywood said, well, this is a movie Disney should have made.
You're more than just fans. You're family.
It's about family, and that's what's so powerful about it.
Hey.
You use a bird to write with. It's called tweeting.
When we visit the world of Disney, we never grow old. It's a Peter Pan, never, never land that keeps us young in heart.
This is Jedi Master Obi-Wan Kenobi, and you are skywalking through Neverland. I have a good feeling about this.
Hey, hey, Skywalkers! We are back celebrating the 40th anniversary of The Empire Strikes Back. And we are so happy you are here with us to celebrate once again. But now, let's welcome everyone to
Skywalking Through Neverland.
We are your enthusiastic podcast destination for the many decades of your Star Wars, Disney, and Marvel fandom. I am Richard Woloski, but now everyone please say hello to my sweetie wife. Hey, sweetie wife Sarah.
Hey, hey, Skywalkers. Hi, sweetie.
Hey.
It's time to give you all a big Wookiee hug to our family of Skywalkers, and a big Wookiee hug to you.
Oh, thank you.
We love it that you're listening to us right now, and if you're watching us live on YouTube, you are our SkyTubers. Hi, SkyTubers. We want to thank you all for listening to the show every single week, and we are here to bring joy on our adventure through fandom.
We are recording this episode from Long Beach, California on May the 19th, 2020. Now, this is a big day for Star Wars, and this is why May should just be renamed May the Force, Uary. Okay? Because there are so many events happening in May around Star Wars.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, here's a rundown of just a few of them. Not all of them, but just a few of them.
Okay.
In May, we have, on May the 1st, 1991, we saw Star Wars finally wake up from the dark times when Heir to the Empire was published.
Woohoo!
And that's just on May 1st. Look what just happened on May 1st. Then, on May 4th, we have the punny holiday of May the 4th be with you.
Yep.
On May the 13th, we have Joe Johnston's birthday. And Joe Johnston, of course, was the concept designer for the Star Wars films, the original trilogy. And pretty much he designed all the ships and characters that you love. He and Ralph McQuarrie and some other people and George Lucas all had a hand in it. But then they gave this big, giant melting pot to Joe Johnston and said, here, finish it up.
Okay.
Also, on that same day, Bea Arthur was born.
Aw.
Now, you have a month when Akmina from the holiday special is born. Right there, that's enough. But wait, there's more. On May the 14th, the Maker was born.
Wow.
Yes. George Lucas's birthday was on May the 14th.
He's a May baby.
Already, we got a big handful of May Star Wars events, but wait, there's more.
Is there more?
There's a whole, that's just the tip of the iceberg. Okay. Here's the whole iceberg right here. On May the 16th, we saw the release of Attack of the Clones.
Wow.
Back in 2002. On today, May the 19th, we had the release of The Phantom Menace in 1999 and Revenge of the Sith in 2005.
Excellent.
Two Star Wars films coming out on one day.
Mm-hmm.
And also, Peter Mayhew's birthday is today, May the 19th.
Which Marcus just mentioned on our live stream.
Hey, hey, Marcus Doring. And then, Sarah, what happened on May the 21st? What film was released that day?
The Empire Strikes Back came out less than a year before I was born.
Yep.
Yay!
That's right. You are a pre-Empire baby.
I am.
All right. Then to continue, on May the 23rd, we saw the first official Star Wars convention, which was held in Los Angeles to honor the 10th anniversary of Star Wars.
Wow.
This is the convention I have dubbed Celebration Zero, which is a big event in May, the first official Star Wars convention. Then on May 25th, we didn't just have two Star Wars films released. We had three Star Wars films released on this date. We had Star Wars back in 1977. We had Return of the Jedi in 1983. Then Solo, A Star Wars Story, in 2018.
Wow. But I forgot that Solo came out May 25th.
Yeah, yeah.
Goodness.
That's the date Star Wars movies should be coming out. But that's not all for May 25th. It's also Frank Oz's birthday.
Whoa. And you know what? The more people who are in Star Wars films, the more birthdays and stuff we'll have to celebrate.
Yeah, and like I said before, I'm not even naming all of the May birthdays.
Right.
But I do have to mention this one right over here on May the 26th. That was Peter Cushing's birthday.
Oh, okay.
Grand Moff Tarkin, Peter Cushing. And then on May 27th was Christopher Lee's birthday.
Whoa!
So you have Grand Moff Tarkin and Count Dooku born a day apart.
Wow. Okay.
All right. You want more? Want more May happenings?
Yes.
In and around Star Wars? All right. On May the 27th, this was the day in 1986 we saw the very last issue of the classic Marvel Star Wars comics.
Okay. What year did you say?
1986.
Wow.
With
okay.
issue 107.
Okay. Why did they stop?
The interest, this is during the Star Wars dark times, so
yes.
things were folding up and being placed in hibernation.
Okay,
until
I understand
that. Heir to the Empire.
But there's one more date in May. Are you ready?
We're all sitting down.
May 31st, Galaxy's Edge opened at Disneyland 2019.
Days away from the one-year anniversary and...
We can't be there.
Oh, okay, no. Happy. We still got Galaxy's Edge, okay? Look at what we do have.
I know. Well, exciting.
No, and just know that it'll be open once again.
Okay, yes. And also we have some Skywalkers weighing in here on YouTube. That Joshua Jordan says that the best people are born in May. George Lucas, my brother, my girlfriend, and myself. Wow. And then Nathan also says...
Happy birthday, Joshua.
Nathan says, I agree. A lot of great people born in May. My sister, my mother, my nephew, and two of my best friends. Theirs are both today. Cool.
Well, happy birthday to everybody. Okay, so who's with me? Should May be called May the Forceuary? Come on, who's with me on this?
It should just be called May the Force. I liked what you had, originally.
May the Forceuary. It just rolls off the tongue.
May the Force.
Okay, go ahead. You know what? Let's pause this and go ahead and hashtag it, Sarah.
Yes.
Okay, good.
I paused it.
Done and done. All right, let's continue, and I'll ask you what time it is now.
Okay. Did you ask me yet?
Oh, yeah. Oh, okay. Mickey? Minnie, what time is it now?
Oh, Richard. It's 3:17 p.m.
Suddenly, Minnie had a little bit of an English lilt there. See, even Joshua Jordan on YouTube agrees with me. We should workshop the name. What do you mean workshop? I thought we already had it there. May the Force you worry.
Oh, he crushed it.
Yes, he did crush that mini impersonation. All right, now Sarah crushed this one. Who is sponsoring this episode of Skywalking Through Neverland?
We are being sponsored by Small World Vacations, and they are a diamond-level Disney vacation planner travel agency that can help you book your trip to Disney parks around the world. I know Disney Springs just half opened, right?
Tomorrow, May 20th.
Okay, tomorrow. That's in Florida. And best of all, their service is free of charge. So head to smallworldvacations.com to start planning fun stuff and get a no-obligation price quote and tell them that Skywalking Through Neverland sent you.
All right, now, coming up on this episode of Skywalking Through Neverland, our good friend Craig Miller, who worked publicity on Empire, he's back to talk with us about what went into getting the word out on this new Star Wars film. There were guest appearances, 1-800 numbers, and his work with Bantha Tracks, which was the official Star Wars fan club. And you know how information gets to you these days on a moment's notice,
mm-hmm,
as it's happening? Well, back then, we had to wait until this quarterly newsletter came out to get our Star Wars news.
Wow.
And Craig, he was the editor and the writer for Bantha Tracks, and I would say that he is the grandfather of Star Wars community fandom.
Definitely. Also on this episode, we have shout-outs, a Skywalker of the Month by Rob Dellinger, and
Things We Want to Share.
Things We Want to Share. Things We Want to Share. Things We Want to Share. Things We Want to Share.
All right, Skywalkers, we want to remind everyone that on May 21st, we will be celebrating the 40th anniversary of The Empire Strikes Back by hosting a Zoom event where Chris Alexander, the author of Star Wars Origami, will be teaching us all how to fold paper so it looks like a lightsaber, a Yoda, and Boba Fett! We are so excited! So if you are interested in this Zoom event, go to the events tab in the Skywalking Through Neverland Facebook page, and you can, you know, join that event. It's open to everyone, and there are links in the event where you can download the paper with designs on them already, so that when you fold Yoda, you know, Yoda's face will be like right there and stuff. It's gonna be awesome. So once again, that's May 21st at 6 p.m. Pacific time. And all that Zoom meeting info with the passwords will also be there in that event on the Skywalking Through Neverland page on Facebook.
Now, one of the greatest lead-ups to the Empire Strikes Back release was when Luke Skywalker, R2-D2, C-3PO, Chewbacca, sans his bandolier, and Luke's cousin, Mark Hamill, visited the Muppet Show on February 23rd, 1980.
Whoa.
And this episode was shot on January 16th, 1980. Raise your hand if you were born on January 16th. Oh, my hand is going up. My hand is going up.
Yay!
Just 11 years before this was shot.
Cool.
Now, Sarah, I just showed you this episode right before we started recording.
Mm-hmm.
So what were your impressions of this crossover?
I thought it was super cute. I mean, how awesome is it? Like, I always love it when you're watching a show. Like, when I was watching Happy Days and all of a sudden Mork from Ork shows up and I'm like, oh my gosh, it's Robin Williams. So it was really cool to see the Star Wars with the Muppets. And I had seen that before with Muppet Babies, but still, this was so cute. And just seeing, anytime you can see the Star Wars actors, like kind of in character, not from the movies.
When they're on Earth.
Right. It's just such a treat. You know, I love, so here's Luke Skywalker and he's doing something different than is all in your memories. So I really appreciated that. And he's wearing his like Dagobah outfit.
He's
right?
Wearing his Bespin fatigues.
Bespin fatigue. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When I saw this back in 1980 and I saw Luke in his brand new outfit and his Bespin fatigues, I immediately fell in love with this costume.
Oh,
And to this day, it's still my favorite costume, I think because of this appearance on The Muppet Show.
Okay. And you have the jacket, and it looks damn good, by the way.
Oh, when they sold this on the fan through the fan club, I got it immediately. Mm-hmm. I love this so much. Now, in this episode, it opens up, as it always does, with Scooter telling the special guest that it's almost showtime.
Angus McGonagall, 15 seconds to curtain, Mr. McGonagall.
Yes, sirree, Scooter, little buddy, I'm raring to go.
Look, it's Luke Skywalker and C-3PO and R2-D2 from Star Wars. Oh, they'd make much better guests than Mr. McGonagall. You're going to have to leave.
Just
Sorry.
A minute, youngster.
Come on, let's go.
Excuse me, Master Luke, but what is this strange world we've come to?
Beats me, 3PO. Seems we've landed on some sort of comedy variety show planet.
And this time, he walks in and it's Angus McGonagall, an Argyle gargoyle who can gargle Gershwin.
Say that five times fast.
I can hardly say it once. So imagine as a kid, I'm watching this expecting to see the stars of Star Wars, but now here's this purple Muppet. And I recall being very frustrated for the next couple of seconds.
I bet.
Because it wasn't the stars of Star Wars. And then a couple of seconds later, here's Luke, R2, and 3PO bursting through the wall.
That was cool.
Of the dressing room.
Yeah. And
Luke thinks it's some kind of a variety show planet.
I know. That was so funny. But they do a variety show, and eventually C-3PO is dancing.
Yeah.
But we'll get to that in a second.
Yeah. In this episode, Luke is much, much tougher than he is in Star Wars. He's got like this hardened, battle-torn attitude. He's
really?
Racing around the Muppet Theater. He's shouting, "Remember Alderaan!" and "Down with the Empire!" Whereas in Star Wars, he was more of the slump-shouldered kid. Now here this was the first time we'd ever seen the more mature Luke Skywalker.
Mm.
And in this episode, Luke and 3PO and R2, they're searching for Chewbacca, where Chewbacca's gone missing, and they happen to end up at the Muppet Theater. So they're running around looking for Chewie, and then we see Luke Skywalker's cousin, Mark Hamill, and he's riffing with Fozzie Bear. He's singing some piano medleys.
He's looking very dapper in a tux,
mm-hmm,
right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, super cool.
And then the big finale of the show was centered around the Pigs in Space sketch, where Luke and the droids, they commandeer the spaceship Swine Trek to look for the missing Chewie. And First Mate Miss Piggy, well, she comes in wearing a Princess Leia outfit.
That must have been so fun to put together for the team. I love her hair.
Yeah, and she's wearing the Star Wars outfit. I'm surprised they didn't put her in an Empire Strikes Back.
Outfit. I'm not. It's so iconic.
It is. Oh, I know. I know that's why, too.
Mm-hmm.
And later on, the crew find out that Chewbacca is imprisoned by Gonzo, who in this episode is the evil villain, Darth Nader.
And it's so funny, his reveal of Darth Vader, because you think it's Darth Vader when he's straight on. And then all of a sudden, Gonzo moves to the side and you can see his big nose. That was great.
And this show has got one of the best lines in it that I quote so many times and no one ever knows what I'm talking about. When Captain Link Hogthrob, he sees Luke's new fatigues and says, "Who's your tailor? I love your outfit." So whenever I see someone in a Bespin fatigue cosplaying outfit, I always throw that line out there. Every once in a while, someone will get it.
Wow.
Because it's very iconic to the vintage age fans.
I did not get that. I'm sorry.
I know. And then in the very end, spoiler alert, at the very end of the sketch, they do rescue Chewbacca, and we see a glimpse into the future. And Sarah, you pointed this out very quickly.
Yeah.
Because the Star Wars cast and the Muppets.
Well, before that, C-3PO is dancing, and the music was doing some like Gershwin thing or something, but then all of a sudden it segs into this
Lucky Star. Not the Madonna Lucky Star, but the Disney.
Okay.
Lucky I once saw a Fred Astaire film.
And he's tap dancing, and oh my gosh, he was like amazing. I'm so glad Anthony Daniels got to be in the costume. I thought that was great. And then that crescendos into the big finale where the entire cast and the Muppets sing When You Wish Upon a Star.
When you wish upon a star.
that castle comes up and there's like shooting stars going off. And it's like, holy cow, Disney and Star Wars.
Yeah, very, very prophetic.
And when was this, 1980?
1980.
So very much before its time. What?
Not only does Disney buy the Muppets, it buys Star Wars.
32 years before its time. Wow.
Okay, here's something that I hope no one steals.
Okay.
Next time when we see Anthony Daniels, and I always have this chambered, my hand is always raised, and I always want to ask him, hey, can you reenact the Muppet tap dance? The Muppet Show,
yes,
tap dance?
I would love to see that. Yes. There's a really good question here on YouTube. Was this before or after the Star Wars Holiday Special?
This was after.
Yes.
The Star Wars Holiday Special came out November 17th, 1978. This was February 23rd, 1980.
There you go.
So this is right at the beginning of starting to publicize The Empire Strikes Back. We got this, and the next month we got the Muppet, we got R2 and 3PO on Sesame Street, which we'll hear about in a little bit with Craig Miller. So it slowly started to roll out.
Okay.
All right, then the week before The Empire Strikes Back opened, the cast made several stops on talk shows. Now here is Mark Hamill and Harrison Ford on the Today Show with Jane Pauley talking about prequels and later sequels.
I can remember 3 years ago with Star Wars when we were anticipating more and more films to come of not a sequel, but a prequel or...
It gets real confusing after a while, doesn't it? But basically, this is the second of three films that tell one story, and they were originally called The Adventures of Luke Skywalker, and it just was too big to get on the marquee.
But it just so happens that the next trilogy after the next film will go 20 years earlier and tell of the young Alec Guinness character and how Darth Vader came to power, and then we wouldn't be involved in those because our characters were just little nippers.
So this is it for you guys?
The third one. The
third one will be?
Which we haven't made yet.
All right, well good. And that's not until 1980.
We started in the middle of 1981 to make it.
I get ahead of myself. The Empire Strikes Back is only out next week, and there are some old faces. Of course, Luke and Princess Leia and Han and so, and C-3PO. And R2-D2, and some new faces, too.
Yes.
Billy Dee Williams is in this movie. We've got another clip. I want to show you as much of the movie as we can get away with without charging you $5 a crack. So take a look at this.
I used to think Jane Pauley was at the top of her game back then. She was the face of NBC.
Okay.
You listen to her now, it's like, Jane, do your research before you go on the air, okay?
I'm getting ahead of myself. Yeah, that was funny.
Yeah, she had done no research before sitting down with these two.
Oh, wow. It's so fun to hear them, though. And yeah, Harrison Ford was like super into it.
Yeah.
I was surprised by that. I guess, when did he start getting a little taciturn?
I would say right in between Raiders and Jedi.
Oh, okay.
At this time, he was headlining his own film, and he wanted to break away from Star Wars, so he was just trying to, you know, do away with it.
Okay.
And plus, Jedi didn't go the way he wanted because Han Solo didn't die, so he was ready to call it a day after Return of the Jedi came out.
Dark Wolf thinks that Harrison Ford sounded a little bored to me. I think he just has low energy.
That's just Harrison Ford.
He's like naturally kind of like low key.
Yeah, and the fact that he jumped right in and started answering questions.
Right.
And Harrison has always said he hates doing interviews. If you give him a script, he'll be on his A game. But during interviews, he just doesn't like it.
Mm-hmm.
He needs a script.
Right.
So if you search around YouTube, you'll find other really fun interviews around this time. There was one really good one with Mark Hamill, Harrison Ford, and Carrie Fisher. And Carrie Fisher does the whole interview in French.
Yes!
Oh my goodness.
It's from a France.
Yeah.
Like, person. Like, yeah, it's amazing.
And Mark and Harrison are sitting back going, yes, I think, but they can't keep up with this. And Carrie's just going, buh, 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 and going on. And you can tell they're very, very impressed with her skills.
Yes.
Yeah. So once again, search around YouTube. There's a ton of them. I just really like this one because it mentioned prequels and later sequels.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Now, Sarah, let's talk with Craig Miller on what he did to publicize The Empire Strikes Back in 1980. And Craig breaks down the different forms of marketing using examples of what we just heard. One is branding, like on The Muppet Show, and the other is in your face, like the coming to a theater near you.
Nice.
Very, very interesting. Here we go.
The first camper arrived at the Cinerama on University Avenue shortly after noon on Tuesday. By 9 at night, the line encompassed several dozen people. The all-night vigil ends Wednesday morning at 11, when these people finally get to buy tickets to the first showing of The Empire Strikes Back.
Do you think this is going to be as big as Star Wars?
Bigger!
And yet a lot of the critics are panning it.
Well, what do they know?
Are you going to be missing any classes by being out here?
Yes.
That doesn't bother you?
No.
When Star Wars premiered at the Valley Circle Theater a couple of years ago, it had a run of 15 months. The manager of the Cinerama expects Empire to make it through Christmas at least. Most of these people think it'll be going strong much longer than that. When they get to the ticket window, it'll be a bargain compared to other theaters in Southern California. Seats are $4 each here. Hundreds waiting in line in Los Angeles will pay $5.50 a ticket. Dave Cohen, News 8.
The months leading up to the premiere of The Empire Strikes Back were filled with hype, guest appearances, and Bantha Tracks. One man was there through it all, Craig Miller, who worked publicity on Empire Strikes Back. And now he's here to go over some of the highlights.
Hey, Craig!
Hey, guys, how are you?
Oh, we're doing better now. Can't wait to start talking about the publicity for The Empire Strikes Back. But looking through your Facebook page here, we see that you've been making some good use of your quarantine time, and you're finding some hidden treasures in your office, huh?
Yeah. My, you know, when you've lived in the same house for 35 years, the office kind of fills up. So we've been excavating, and I've been a lot of stuff has gone away, and I've been finding some stuff. It's like, oh yeah, I forgot I had that box. Look at those photos. Just all kinds of cool memories.
Are you going to post any of these photos or findings?
Slowly. I'll be posting them. And of course, this week I found a box with a number of embroidered patches, the Darth Vader in flames,
ooh,
Empire Strikes Back patch. And actually, it turns out the ones I have are not the more common ones. Plus, they were reproduced by the Star Wars fan club later. But mine are actually from an early test run and have more colors in them. But then we made up a bigger batch that were simpler and so cheaper to make. So there's actually two different crew patches of the Vader in Flames plus the fan club version and some Star Wars logo patches that we use. That was in this box. Plus, we had, when you went to visit Elstree Studios during the production on Empire, we had made up these intergalactic passports with, you know, fake passport stamps for Tatooine and Alderaan and Yavin and that kind of thing. So they were sort of cool souvenirs for people who came to visit. And I found some of those as well.
Wow.
So those were all fun to see again.
Is this the first time you've seen them since? Since you last put them away in a drawer?
Yeah, I remember this box of stuff from probably 10 years ago, and then it got buried. You know, you clean up and then you can't find anything. So,
yeah. Are you going to do anything with these patches? Like put them on a display shadow box or on some clothing?
Well, I'm going to keep some for myself, but I really don't need six of them. So some of them are going to go up for auction with Prop Store.
Oh,
ooh,
nice.
Exciting.
All right. Now let's go back 40 years ago, almost to the week now, to the time when you worked at Lucasfilm. So tell us some of your fondest memories of publicizing The Empire Strikes Back.
Well, Empire was kind of a cool thing. Of course, we had the advantage of Star Wars had come out 3 years before. So we were pretty sure there was an audience for the movie. When we were doing Star Wars, that was almost an entirely different world. People, science fiction movies weren't popular. So Star Wars really changed that. So we knew it wasn't that hard to publicize Empire, but we still treated it as if it was. We went out of our way to do things to market the movie and didn't just say, oh, people will come to see the sequel to Star Wars.
What is your fondest memory of Empire, of publicizing Empire? The one thought when someone asks you about the days working on Empire, there's that one thought that always comes to your mind first. What is that?
Well, there's two different ones. One of them is, of course, we've got R2-D2 and C-3PO to guest star on Sesame Street. And I was producer for Lucasfilm on those Sesame Street segments. And also was R2 used to take two people to operate. So I would be one of the operators on things like the Sesame Street episodes.
Oh, look, R2. There's our large yellow bird friend. Hello, friend bird.
Hi, C-3PO. Hi, little R2-D2.
Pardon the intrusion, but you don't seem your normal, happy, bubbly bird-like self today. Is anything troubling you?
Well, I don't know. It's just that today, I can't seem to get my numbers straight. I can't tell my 1 from a 4 or a 3 from a 2. I don't know what to do.
An excellent suggestion, R2. We are computerized robots. We're experts in numbers. Perhaps we can help you with your numbers.
Oh, would you?
It really isn't difficult. You see, if it says 1, you go. If it says 2, you go. If it says 3, then you go. And that's the way it's done.
The other thing that's my fond memory, which is more personal, is that when I was at a science fiction convention in Chicago to market Empire in the autumn of 79, and I met this young woman from New York, and 3 weeks later I was in New York to do the Sesame Street episode. I called her, we went out on a date, and 40 years later we're
40 years later you're still married?
Yep.
Aww, that must be Jenny.
Yes, it is Jenny. We didn't get married immediately, of course, but so it's from having been in Chicago and her having been in Chicago to attend that convention for Empire, we wouldn't have met, you know, so I have to think fondly about Empire from that as well.
Wow, that's quite a love story. I love that.
Yeah. You know, on Sesame Street and even the Muppets, they never mentioned The Empire Strikes Back. On Sesame Street, you had R2 and 3PO, and on the Muppets, you had the cast of Star Wars, like Mark Hamill and R2 and 3PO and Chewie, but never did they say, hey, coming to a theater near you. Was that ever something that was ever in the cards, or did they say, no, let's not bat people over the head too hard with this, they'll know it?
Yeah, there's different ways of marketing things. There are places where you don't need to say, and by the way, coming up is... Because there was a lot of other things going on marketing The Empire Strikes Back. And of course, as we got closer, there were TV advertisements and articles and magazines and that sort of thing. So there's also a recognition advertising. Mm-hmm. You have the actors and the characters out there to cause people to remember, oh yeah, Star Wars. Oh yeah, didn't I hear that there was a new movie coming? And as we would get closer, you know, they would see Empire Strikes Back other ways. So we really didn't need to hammer it home on Sesame Street, where it would be kind of out of place anyway.
Was that a conscious decision?
It was. I mean, it was semi-conscious. We knew we weren't going to be saying The Empire Strikes Back. We were just going to have, with Sesame Street, R2 and 3PO there. It was. We consciously knew we weren't going to be mentioning it. We knew that having them there helps keep it be in people's minds.
You didn't really need to hammer over the people's heads because there were so many advertisements out there, the billboards and Bantha Tracks, which was the official Star Wars newsletter, and this is something that you edited.
Yeah, I was, as director of fan relations, I developed the fan club, and for the first couple of years wrote everything and all of the issues of Bantha Tracks. So, yeah, so that was all my stuff. And, of course, while part of it was we talked about Star Wars, the first movie, we then also talked about, and coming up in whatever, however long away it was, there will be the Empire Strikes Back. So we had articles about Empire. We had an interview I conducted with Irv Kirshner, who directed Empire, things like that.
It was a great Harrison Ford interview, Anthony Daniels, Mark Hamill. And in the fourth issue, it was officially announced that the name of the Star Wars sequel was going to be The Empire Strikes Back.
Whoa, when did the fourth issue come out?
Like that was in the September of 1977. Oh, 78. 1978.
Okay.
Yeah. And I know that Gary Kurtz was just throwing the title out there because he didn't like when interviewers would say Star Wars 2. So during one Japanese press conference, he just blurted out The Empire Strikes Back.
Originally, we just called it Star Wars 2 around the office because it didn't have a name. You had to refer to it as something. But George didn't like those numbers, you know, title with the same title. Number. So we avoided calling it anything. And everyone was always being asked, what's the title going to be? And Gary, as you say, was in Japan, completely inundated by reporters who all asked that question. And finally, he just made up The Empire Strikes Back to get them to, you know, basically to get them to take an answer and go away.
Wow.
That title ended up sticking.
A big, new, sprawling space adventure in the Star Wars saga, The Empire Strikes Back. Coming to your galaxy next summer.
Yeah, that was all over the trades. Variety picked it up, The Hollywood Reporter, and then officially in that issue number 4, Star Wars fan club said, okay, it's now The Empire Strikes Back. It is official.
So what I want to know is, when will Baby Yoda's name officially be Baby Yoda?
last December. also in issue number 4, there was an extensive Star Wars trivia contest. Did you write this?
I did write it, although I'm not sure I could answer those questions anymore.
Oh, only if I had written some of those questions out. Hey, look, I got some of these questions written out.
What?
Okay, Craig, let's see how much you remember from your own trivia questions, okay?
Let me just say in defense of what I'm going to do now, I was the guy at Lucasfilm when anyone had a question about what was the name of this or how did we do that, the other people at the company would come to me to ask those questions. So back then, I remembered everything.
We'll start you off easy. How many different types of vehicles were in Star Wars and name them?
Oh, God.
Yeah. Several.
Not according to what you had written back in 1978.
They all had a letter as part of their name.
Very good. All right. Well, almost.
The answers you had given back then, you had said there were 10 shown. The X-Wing, the Y-Wing, TIE Fighter, Millennium Falcon, Rebel Blockade Runner, Star Destroyer, Land Speeder, Sandcrawler, Escape Pod, and the Death Star.
Wow.
And there was, we also referred to the T-16.
Yes. Oh! Boy, that is a deep cut. Do you recall writing that?
No, I just remember that the T-16 was, you know, because that's that Luke's famous line. Oh, it's like, you know,
shooting womp rats at my T-16 back home.
Nice.
Okay, another question. According to his uncle, what had Luke's father done during the Clone Wars?
Oh, gosh, I don't remember.
He was a navigator on a spice freighter.
Oh, I feel like I should have known that one.
Yeah, you really should have. Okay, we'll edit in your answer later on.
Navigator on a spice freighter. All right, I'll ask this question. What was the number of the cell block where they were holding Princess Leia?
1138.
That was the prisoner transfer number.
Boy, then I don't remember the cell block.
Is it AA23?
AA23.
Holy cow! I pulled that one out.
All right. One more, and this might be a hard one. What was the new model land speeder that had come out and lessened the value of Luke's land speeder? Boy, that is a deep, deep cut back in 1978 when you couldn't go to the internet.
Yeah, no clue.
Wow, you're looking at me, Richard. Luke
had mentioned it.
Yeah.
Very quickly.
Oh, believe me, I know the scene too, but I'm not thinking of the dialogue.
Ever since the came out, these are just not in demand.
The new one came out. The new one.
Toyota RAV4 is correct.
No. What is it?
The XP38.
Oh God, I would never got that.
XP38.
Okay. That's awesome.
All right. Well, you know what? Jumping ahead to the next issue, issue 5, that's where you introduced Boba Fett. All right, this is what the blurb said. Not much is known about Boba Fett. He wears the parts of the uniform of the Imperial Shock Troopers, warriors from the olden times. Shock Troopers came from the far side of the galaxy, and there aren't many of them left. They were wiped out by the Jedi Knights during the Clone Wars. Whether he was a Shock Trooper or not is unknown.
Whoa. So... okay, this brings me to The Mandalorian, where Gina Carano plays a shock trooper.
A rebel shock trooper.
Right, which is interesting.
And we see these shock troopers in Revenge of the Sith. They're the clone troopers with the red markings.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure I wrote that.
All right, now, where did this information come from, the fact that he might have been a shock trooper?
I took it from material we had that came from George.
Because up until now, there were just a few blurbs mentioned in the Joe Johnston Empire Strikes Back sketchbook. There was that little pamphlet that came with the Boba Fett action figure. And there was an article written in Starlog. But I'm guessing Starlog had gotten their information from the Star Wars fan club because they had mentioned in that Starlog article about him, Boba Fett, being a shock trooper.
Hmm. Yeah. We worked with the guys at Starlog a lot.
Yeah, I remember reading this in the fan club, and I got really excited. Shock trooper? What's a shock trooper?
Right.
There's more stormtrooper type of soldiers out there?
So that being said, what does a shock trooper do?
It's just a different kind of stormtrooper. Mm-hmm. Kind of like you have shore troopers and snow troopers.
We had no idea. It was just a good phrase. And if someday they got shown, they come up with it. You know, it's like all the different armor that, you know, there's stormtroopers, there's snow troopers, there's all kinds of slight variations. The helmets seem to be, you know, they're not stormtroopers, they're driving the AT-ATs, but they still wear variant helmets. So those are all, you know, The reality is that they're developed as they're needed.
Right. Okay.
All right. Now, in the next issue, issue 6, there's an Empire progress report, and I thought this was worthy of bringing up now. It says, Empire has wrapped. All the actors are now home and resting. Mark Hamill is spending time with his wife and newborn son. Harrison Ford is remodeling his home in Beverly Hills. Carrie Fisher is once again before the cameras, this time appearing in The Blues Brothers. Doesn't sound like they're home and resting at all.
Well, different people rest different ways.
That, a truer statement was never said. Says me sitting on the couch playing my video game and Richard is like editing in his room or planning the next episode or whatever you're doing over there.
Very, very true. And then, also, in a month or two leading up to The Empire Strikes Back, there were the 800 numbers. Now, I know we've gone over this before, but give us, in a nutshell, these 800 numbers and how much fun they were. And were these something that you had written and produced yourself?
There was something I came up with the idea for, since 800 numbers were relatively new, answering machines were relatively new, they still worked on little cassette tapes. And I thought, you know, you call up a movie theater and you get a recording that tells you what's playing. Can we do that with messages from the actors, actually messages from the characters? And we did the research, and yes, we could. And we figured it out, and everyone who needed to gave me their blessing. And I wrote 5 different messages from Luke, Leia, C-3PO, Solo, and Darth Vader. And then we recorded them all using the actual actors, recorded them. Everyone recorded when they came in to loop the dialogue for Empire, except for Harrison, who had already done his looping. So I got a sound man, and we went up to Harrison's house and recorded his message.
His newly remodeled house in Beverly Hills, huh?
His ongoingly. I mean, some of it was remodeling, and some of it was, you know, Harrison loved carpentry and woodworking, and he had a small, it was really like a closet underneath the stairs in his house, filled with his match carpentry tools with the polished wood handles and stuff. When I went to visit, he took me to the closet to show me his tools because he really loved that. He was really big into carpentry. So he was always fixing things up in the house. I don't know if he still does that, but certainly back then. But we recorded them. We made arrangements to have the phone number we wanted, which is 800-521-1980, 521 May 21st, 1980. So you could call the number that was the release date, at least the U.S. release date, and hear the messages. We didn't have computers back then. So for a month, you got the C-3PO message. And then the next month, you got the Luke Skywalker message. It couldn't be randomized. So if you just kept calling, you would get a different message.
Yeah. And I remember we went over this in one of our previous episodes where the phone lines just completely went down because so many people called in for these messages.
Unknowingly, there was so much interest in calling this number that it completely shut down the 800 system for the state of Illinois, which is where our phone room was, for a day and a half until it could be fixed. And we put in more phone lines, and then the problems went away. But yeah, it was enormously popular.
I know, so popular that I've tried a billion times and never, ever got through. Oh, no. Yeah. Were you there when Carrie Fisher was recording her lines for the phone line? I've heard the outtakes, and she wasn't too happy with some of the dialogue.
You know, they were all basically sight reading. They had never seen the script until they got in that day. And we said, could you please record this for a promotional thing? I mean, some of the actors had a little trouble. Others didn't. Carrie said, why do they give me dialogue like a fairy princess? And it's like, well, that's your character. And she did have trouble with the word scourge, where she talks about the scourge of the galaxy.
The destruction of the Death Star was a major victory for the rebellion, but our battle isn't over yet. Darth Vader and the evil forces of the Emperor keep a stranglehold over the galaxy. But the Rebel Alliance must and will succeed in forever ridding the galaxy of their scourge.
What the hell is
scourge.
That?
Scourge. Why do you give me this ancient dialogue to say? Scourge? Do we all say scourge and I missed it?
You know, there are lots of words people have never seen written out before. And so they stumble over them because they've heard the word. They know the word. They've just never seen it written down before. And I got to admit that even though I wrote that line, scourge was not a word you saw a lot of in contemporary usage.
Yeah, or use. Were you there when she recorded that?
Yeah, I was there when everyone recorded.
Okay.
Okay.
Cool. Did you help her through that, or did you suggest a...
No, actually, Gary was in the booth with her. I was at the recording desk, so Gary helped her with it.
Okay. It's funny also hearing James Earl Jones wanting to nail these lines. It's like, nope, do it again. Vader is a perfectionist. Nice.
They managed. Repeating. They managed
to rescue the princess. Nope. They managed to rescue the princess and to destroy the death. They managed to rescue the princess.
Yeah, he was. I mean, and he was, you know, if you not just delivering the Darth Vader lines, but if you've seen him actually performing in other movies where he is, you know, he's on camera, and I've seen him on stage as well. He's just a tremendously talented performer, and he is a perfectionist. He's going to get it right.
Yeah, mm-hmm. and especially because Vader's got a very unique way of speaking. So right. If he said something that wasn't in the Vader cadence, like, oh, got to do it again. Now, do you recall what else you had worked on in preparation for The Empire Strikes Back?
Oh, gosh. I mean, we did lots of things. A lot of it was not quite as visible from the point of view of, from the public's point of view. I mean, I worked with a lot of magazines. I worked with a lot of outlets for publicity. We did a lot of stuff at science fiction and comic book conventions and science fiction and comic book stores to set up displays and that sort of thing. We did a lot of commercials with our licensees. We had Darth Vader going out and doing in-store appearances. Bryce Eller always wore the Darth Vader costume for that sort of thing. I worked on some commercials. Most notoriously, we did the Underoos commercial.
In the not-so-distant future on a planet called Earth, it's Underoos.
Star Wars Boba Fett is here. That means Darth Vader's always near. C-3PO is lots of style. And R2-D2 just makes me smile. Star Wars Underoos are here, yeah! Something out of sight in underwear.
Don't be so ridiculous, R2. Underoos are for Earthlings.
There's no underwear in space, as George Lucas had once said.
Yes, but there is underwear here on Earth. and so we did a commercial for Underoos. I mean, when we did tie-in stuff like that, we did not create the commercial. We didn't write the commercial. We just approved or not the material and then provided actors in costumes or R2-D2 or whatever to appear in it. With Underoos, we had a Boba Fett, a C-3PO, and we also had R2 in the Underoos commercial.
Was that Anthony Daniels in the C-3PO outfit?
No, it was... I don't know if it was... Bob Short did some of our Underoos appearances. Or not Underoos appearances, C-3PO appearances. Bob went on to win a couple of Academy Awards as a special effects makeup guy for things like Beetlejuice and Splash and lots of other movies. But he did do appearances for us as 3PO, but I don't remember if Bob was in the 3PO costume for the Underoos shoot. And R2, we used the radio controlled R2. We didn't have anyone in the R2 costume. Kenny was not brought in for it. Kenny wasn't brought in for Sesame Street either, but we did bring in Tony Daniels for those.
Now, you know what? You had done a lot of slideshows at science fiction conventions. Do you recall the public viewpoint on Empire or the reactions? Or did anyone ever say, hey, I wonder if this is going to happen? Or is Darth Vader Luke's father? Or guess plot point that you had to quickly just gloss right over.
I don't recall anyone ever asking questions like that. I'm sure they did. And there was at least one time where someone said, and I don't remember anymore what it was they said, but they asked, does thus and such happen? And I said, that's just a rumor.
Moving right along very quickly.
Right.
Yeah.
Had you seen the film early?
Yeah, I saw. I spent 5 weeks at the studio during what production, actually in two separate trips, 2 weeks and 3 weeks, where I saw dailies And then I didn't see it again until early May when we had a screening for the people at Lucasfilm.
But you knew a lot of the plot points going in.
Well, I had read the script.
And what did you think when the big moment was revealed that Vader was Luke's father? Or was that in the script? Did they take those pages out?
Well, that depends on who you were. I was very fortunate that they thought it appropriate to give me the script that page was in, that I would need to know it. But a lot of people, including people at the studio shooting, their script did not have the key page where Darth Vader says, "Luke, I am your father." So I did know, and yes, it was a surprise when I read it, but a lot of people didn't.
Wow. And at conventions, did you happen to say, here's Darth Vader, and he's not Luke's father, so don't go there. Did that ever come out?
Yeah, I think I avoided that.
Yeah, Richard.
Well, you can always say to George, I said, don't think that, people. Covering my bases here. Did you also handle the publicity and promotion for overseas? Because there were some pretty wacky things happening over in Japan.
No, I didn't do anything in Japan, and the only thing I did in England was when I was over there, we did a big exhibit and presentation at what was the World Science Fiction Convention that year, was held in Brighton, and then I was up in Birmingham for the Birmingham Comic Con, where I did a slideshow. But that was the only stuff I did in England, other than sending, you know, press releases and that sort of thing over.
Gotcha.
Do you ever see anything that you did publicity-wise on Star Wars or Empire Strikes Back that has been borrowed for another film?
Oh, sure. I mean, everything we, not just me, but lots of people, Charlie Lippincott in particular, did that was invented for Star Wars and Empire have become the standard ways to market movies, especially genre movies. I mean, no one went to places like the San Diego Comic-Con or the World Science Fiction Convention. You know, it was the thought of going directly to the audience was unheard of. The 800 messages we did have since been done. I mean, the internet has changed a bunch of stuff, but other movies did phone messages like that. I was very surprised when one of the Star Trek movies, they did it, and they did it with a 900 number, which meant you had to pay to hear the message.
Wow.
Oh, no.
I thought that was kind of cheesy, but a lot of places have done that. Yeah, a lot of the stuff we did became the standard way to do things. I mean, there's a marketing term that came out in the early part of this century, in the early 2000s, called transmedia, which is doing stuff so it's in not just a TV show or not just a movie, but there's also books and comics and games and this and that and the other thing. And I was at a conference or a panel about transmedia during the period it was the hot term. And someone in the audience said, "What's the best transmedia campaign you've ever seen?" And every member of the panel said, "Star Wars."
Wow.
We weren't doing transmedia. That term didn't exist. We were doing, let's get Star Wars in every place we can try to get Star Wars, so that we can counteract this image that science fiction had back in the 70s and get people to think about Star Wars as something cool and interesting and that they would go to the movie. We apparently invented transmedia. We just didn't know it. So yeah, a lot of stuff that was done for Star Wars. And again, Charlie Lippincott was really the one behind a lot of it. And then we continued after Charlie left, doing that sort of thing. A lot of the stuff is continued to be done. Now with the internet, you see people doing similar stuff, but it's online. So you don't have to call. You just come and you see they were doing it with the Lord of the Rings movies. They were doing it with other movies where you could have the director's personal diary where he would record, you know, 1 minute segments talking about, we're going to do this in the movie and that kind of stuff. So it all comes out of the stuff that was done for Star Wars and Empire. And of course, people were inventing new stuff as well.
Yeah.
Craig, we love hearing these stories. This was a great time in my life because I just loved everywhere I looked, there was always something else of The Empire Strikes Back, whether it was commercials or appearances on shows or guest appearances on talk shows or toys or everything. That just brings back such great memories for me, and I love talking to you about this stuff. But a lot of these stories are well documented in your book. Where can people find your book?
Star Wars Memories, My Time in the Death Star Trenches. But Star Wars Memories is the title, and Gary Kurtz did the foreword for it shortly before he passed away. And they can find it online, both in paperback and on Amazon, and also Barnes & Noble online has it available.
Great. Awesome. Yeah. And there's such great stories. And, you know, it's fun to listen to you on our shows, but it's also fun to read and just consume for yourself. And so thank you for writing that book, Craig.
Yeah. Thank you guys for plugging it from the beginning and helping me to promote it. I've been very fortunate. There's been a great reaction to it on Amazon. The reviews are like 97% five stars. So
nice.
And I think the only non-five stars are four stars.
Oh, no one-star reviews? That means you haven't made it.
Yeah.
All the reviews have been great. A couple people were upset that the photo quality it's not a photo book. It just has photos. And it's not on glossy paper. It's just on regular paper. So if you're looking for great photo reproduction, you got to go to some of the photo books. This is really a book of stories about the making and promotion and fandom around Star Wars and Empire that has photo illustration.
Well, you know what? You keep working hard and sooner or later you'll get a one-star review, which means you've ticked someone off and then you know you've really made
yes.
it in fandom.
Yeah. Yes. Well, you know, I'll keep trying.
Yeah. Just maybe next time have it printed on newsprint. maybe miss a couple of pages. You know what? You'll get there, Craig. You'll get there. All right, Craig. Well, thank you very, very much. Yeah, are there any stories that you have never told? Something that you thought, you know what? When I get around to it, or no one's asked me about this,
or maybe saving it for your next book.
Not stories that I would say for general public dissemination.
Gotcha. Okay.
Okay. Next time we see you.
So next house party.
Yeah. Gotcha.
Okay, guys. Thanks for having me. Take care.
All right.
Thank you. You too.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Star Wars Underoos are here, yeah! Something out of sight in underwear.
Don't be so ridiculous, R2. Underoos are for Earthlings.
Shout-outs. Skywalker, shout-outs. Which Skywalkers get props from here in Neverland? Who was tweeted out? Shout out. Who was photoballed? Shout out. Who was shared a post? Shout out.
You know how every week we always ask for the Skywalkers to leave us a review on Apple Podcasts or Stitcher? Well, we got one this week.
Woohoo!
And I'm really appreciative of Jimmy from Pennsylvania. He gave us 5 stars and says, thanks to Mostalgia, I have found a great Star Wars podcast. Thank you. You guys are great.
Wow, Jimmy. Thank you so much. I wonder if that's from, let's see, on Mostalgia, Jeff Bam. He mentioned that when they went around the circle telling what podcast they listened to every week, Jeff mentioned us. So thank you, Jeff.
And we'll mention them right back. If you want your fill of Disney, you got to go to Mostalgia.
Yeah, it's a really, really good show. We love it, too. We listen every week. All right. Also, for shout-outs, I want to give a shout-out to Patty Hammond. She posted in our Facebook group a picture of her in her Skywalking Through Neverland shirt and her Rey face mask, which I made. And she said, at the park, just finished my walk, and of course, wearing my Skywalking Through Neverland mask and tee. She was representing. Thanks, Patty.
Thank you, Patty. And we got a tweet from Christopher Marino. Is he on right now? I think he's one of our YouTubers.
I think so.
He's a SkyTuber.
Yeah.
Chris says, not my best run. Oh, it could be he's part of the Hoojib Fitness Hop Club.
Right.
But thanks at Skywalking Pod for keeping me company with your latest episode. Run was not a failure, but a learning experience. And he left a picture of himself as he's running and sweating.
But it has his mileage on it, and it was 8 kilometers in 1 hour, which is a fantastic time. It's like under 8-minute mile. So, Christopher, I don't know what your good run is, but that's like amazing. So congratulations, and congratulations for keeping up with exercising, even though we're all cooped up at home. Like, that's props. And he's here.
Okay, how far is 8 kilometers?
Well, 5 kilometers is 3 miles, about. So 8 kilometers would be about 4-something miles.
Wow.
I think. Yeah, 5, 6, 7, 8. Oh, yeah, it's like 4 to 5 miles, somewhere in there. Yeah.
Well, we did 4 to 5 miles yesterday.
No, we didn't.
It took us 24 hours to do 4 or 5 miles walking around the living room. But I'm guessing it came up to 5 miles.
Well, I think that's pretty awesome. Oh, 4.97 miles.
Oh, Chris. Okay, what prevented you from going that extra 0.03 miles?
I don't know. Oh, my God.
That's like
so
you
funny.
Walk up to the front door and you've made it.
Martin, it's about 8 kilometers further than I can run.
All right, nice, nice. All right, now it's time to reveal Rob Dellinger's Skywalker of the Month. We're not going to say who it is because that person right now is one of our SkyTubers.
Oh,
all right, Rob, take it away.
He's a Lego enthusiast. He likes writing fan fiction and Clone Wars reviews. He's 14-year-old Jonathan Marroquin.
So congratulations to this Skywalker who is a SkyTuber. And this person has been commenting and on a lot of our social media posts and coming to all of our online Zoom and Facebook parties and has been contributing in lots and lots of ways. So congratulations to you. Now, if you want to become a Skywalker of the Month, very easy. Just go on social media, post some stuff or comment on some stuff, leave a review for us.
Yeah, just interact with us. Like we love that, Skywalkers. And also share your hashtag Skywalker selfie. On yeah. Instagram or on YouTube or on Twitter, wherever you want.
Okay, how about this? The first person I see hashtag May the Force You Wary will get the next Skywalker of the Month. Go. And Sarah, who does these Skywalker of the Month jingles?
Well, those are composed by Rob Dellinger, the John Williams of podcasting. And if you want to see what he's up to next, go to alpharhythmkings.com. That is his band. And they are doing some live streams lately. They've been doing some things. So just keep up with him. And he's got a whole bunch of stuff going on. We love Rob. All right, Skywalkers, I want to remind everyone that we are still going strong creating face masks for fandom. Just yesterday, I finally had a chance to update my fabric catalog with new fabric that's been donated by Chica Fent, Connie Shee, and Lisa Woloski, sister-in-law. And I have Star Wars sheets material. You know what, Skywalkers? I'll show you.
That really plugs the heartstrings of all the vintage classic fans.
And I already have a couple orders for that, already requested. And then Connie Shee contributed, and we've got this cool little Mickey Mouse ones. Look how cute these are. So all you have to do to check out what I have available, you can go to skywalkingthroughneverland.com, and on the drop-down menu there, or on the upper menu, there's face masks. You just click that. The masks are $12 each. They can be customized for kids, for adults. They can have elastic or ties. And for any more of that info, head there and you can fill out that. There's a form that you can fill out and it'll go straight to the email where your order will be. Also, Skywalkers, I want you to be aware that we will be doing two more rounds of Baby Yoda face mask pre-orders in the coming month, and each of these will be slightly different. So if you're interested in being notified first about these Baby Yoda pre-orders, sign up for my email list. Just send an email to sarahwoloskydesigns@gmail.com.
All right, Skywalkers, that does it for episode 290 of
Skywalking Through Neverland.
We'd like to thank Craig Miller for coming back on the show and sharing all of his stories. And we want to thank all you Skywalkers for listening right now and watching our videos, listening to our shows, and everything that you do.
We'd also like to thank our sponsor, Small World Vacations, for their continued support. You can fill out a get a quote form at smallworldvacations.com today as you daydream. I know I've been doing that a lot. Their vacation planning service is free of charge, so check it out and tell them that Skywalking Through Neverland sent you.
Now, do you love Skywalking Through Neverland?
Yes, we do.
Oh, that's great. Do you want more content?
Yeah, we'd love more content.
Well, consider becoming a member of the Skywalking Force, which is our Patreon. And we are now releasing a new Skywalking Force episode every other week, and it's called Skywalking Force of Fun.
Yes, and this...
Fun, no, no.
Oh, fun.
I need my reverb.
I'm sorry.
Of fun.
Fun. And this week, Skywalkers, we're going to record right after we sign off with you guys. It's going to be Harry Potter themed. I'm going to put Richard into the sorting hat. It's going to be so fun. So this bonus content, that begins at only $5 a month, which is not much at all. So you can head to skywalkingforce.com and have a look at the options. Thank you to those of you who are already part of the Skywalking Force. We love it.
Now, to find more Skywalking Through Neverland, well, you can head right over there to jedinews.co.uk and at Bantha Tracks.
We are part of the Skywalking Network.
Skynet.
Where you can find other great shows like Sabers and Spells.
Talking Apes.
And classic Marvel Star Wars comics.
And to find us on social media.
We are at Skywalking Pod for Twitter, Instagram, and TikTok. We also have our Facebook group where lots of things are going on. So you can search Facebook for Skywalking Through Neverland group and request to join. Also, make sure to check the events tab at our Skywalking Through Neverland Facebook page or group, because we have different events going on at different times. You can email us, share@skywalkingthroughneverland.com. And you can even leave a review on Apple Podcasts or Stitcher or even in Facebook.
And we thank you in advance.
And Skywalkers, just so you know, I'm on Animal Crossing thanks to our good friend Teresa Delgado. So if you're interested in being friends with me there and maybe visiting my island, then hit me up somewhere, DM me, and I'll give you my code.
Is this something like TikTok?
No. No, it's an Animal Crossing thing. It's super fun.
Explain it to me later on.
Yeah.
All right, Skywalkers, now don't forget to stick around for bloopers and other fun bits of conversation that didn't make it into the show. And
always remember,
never land on Alderaan.
To our Skywalkers and Tweetwalkers, thanks for listening. Skywalking Through Neverland is created and produced by Richard and Sarah Woloski. Original music by Rob Dellinger. Creative consultant, Mark Augushowitz. Technical advisor, Peter Heitman. Facebook administrators, Donald Wicks, Joey Pittman, and Norma Heitman.
Skywalking Through Neverland is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. Any sounds, music, and clips played during this podcast are the property of their copyright holders. All original content is property of Skywalking Through Neverland, all rights reserved. Sorry, had to be said.
Now, so Courtney, just FYI, I know you're being careful. Thank you, Courtney. But I believe Fluff Keeler is Martin Keeler, and he's one of our Skywalkers. So,
is that Martin?
Yeah, I think so. Martin, you have a weird screen name, apparently. All right. That's all.
Courtney, okay. Courtney's our skywalking bouncer.
That's right.
Jim, I know I called you Sean Astin.
Oh.
Jim Astin.
Oh, whoops. Oh, that's funny. Okay. Yeah, see, they're all excited. Oh, yay.
Oh, very good. Glad everyone's gonna be joining us.
Yeah, I'm excited. Yeah, Chris is really good at teaching origami. Like, he's very calm and very, like, origami to me can be frustrating if you've ever tried to read the directions and try to do it yourself. Like, the mountain folds and the valley folds and, like, what the heck are you talking about? But he knows, and he's very good at doing it.
And Sarah, if it weren't for you taking one of Chris's classes at Celebration 4, 5, or 6, or 7.
I think it was 5.
Yeah, you took Chris's class.
In
the kids' room, and came back with his Jango Fett origami with Chris Alexander's car. And it's like, Chris Alexander, I wonder if it's the same Chris Alexander I used to know back in 1984. And just so happens it was. Mm-hmm. So I'm so happy, Sarah, you took Chris's class.
Yeah.
What's the time frame for that?
Well, I don't know. First, I'm putting together a box of stuff that prop store is going to go through, and then it's up to them how soon the auction that these will go into will be. So it's probably a number of months away. I mean, I'll get a box to them in the next couple weeks, but it takes them a while. They have to process everything, photograph it, put together the catalog, and publicize the auction and that sort of thing.
Nice. I think that was Brandon on the phone right now from the prop store saying, Craig, don't say anything just yet. Not just yet. It's a surprise.
And Kenny wasn't brought in for Sesame Street either, but we did bring in Tony Daniels for those.
Yeah, we had mentioned on a previous show that it took some doing to get him over here to the United States.
Oh, right. Right.
On a dime. But you know what? The Skywalkers.
Dime. The cost was up there. It's everyone had forgotten that he was going to need to get a work visa to appear on television. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so it wasn't until the last minute that I remembered and had to jump through hoops and get other people to jump through hoops to get him a work visa, because the I guess it's the State Department or whatever department it is that approves visas, their attitude was, hey, it's a guy in a mask, it could be an American actor, we don't need to give a visa to bring someone in to do that.
Little did they know.
Yes. Yeah, so I ended up calling Alan Cranston, who was the U.S. Senator for California, one of them, and a very powerful senator, and got his staff to pull some strings to get a rapid approval, and then called the general counsel for Sesame Street, the general counsel's their head attorney, and said to him, because someone in New York had to sign on behalf of Sesame Street that they needed Tony to be there. So I called the general counsel and said, your staff forgot to make arrangements for a work, but I fixed it. You need to send someone over to the visa office in Manhattan and sign the paperwork so that Tony can pick it up tomorrow before he leaves London.
Wow. A nice way to spin that one.
And so they were like, oh my God, we've got to do that. And so they sent someone empowered to sign to the visa office. They signed the visa paperwork. And in England, Tony got picked up by a limo, driven to the American Embassy in London, where he was handed his visa, his work visa. And
wow.
From there to Heathrow Airport, where he got on the plane to come to New York, where we shot Sesame Street.
Wow.
Having a different actor doing C-3PO and Underoos commercial is one thing, but on Sesame Street, you need the man himself.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
He isn't saying anything. He's just sort of kind of dancing in a 10-second clip. On Sesame Street, we filmed 5 segments where he had a lot of dialogue. So we needed Tony.
Definitely.
Oh, yeah, yeah. If you're going to do something like this, yeah, so much. If they've seen Star Wars, they'll know that they need Anthony on that set.
Did any of you guys watch the Disney Gallery this past week where it was the cast talking about The Mandalorian and how somewhere someone mentioned something about how Star Wars characters, when they're designing the costumes and stuff, the profile of the character or the, what is it? The silhouette of the character is always very iconic. And that's what they tried to do with the Mandalorian costumes. Well, that made me think of Miss Piggy and her ears, you know, like that's why they did that. And then here, similarly, they played on that with, what's his name as Darth Vader?
Gonzo.
With Gonzo as Darth Nader, you know, you show him in the profile, you see the helmet, you're like, oh, that's Darth Vader. And he turns to the side. It's like, oh, no, it's Gonzo. So I just think it's really cool with something so iconic like that, that you can play off that very easily. And it makes a great joke just visually. So I'm wondering, is there any other like epics or things that we love that have those kind of profiles that Star Wars does, those silhouettes that are so like iconic
within Star Wars?
No, not within Star Wars, just any other fandoms. Like,
okay.
Yeah.
I don't know.
But Skywalkers, think on that while we're moving on here.
Okay. Jim asks, what does a Skywalker selfie entail?
Oh.
Getting your phone?
Yes.
And taking a selfie and...
Yeah, so basically stop what you're doing, whatever you're doing while you're listening to us, and take out your phone and take a selfie of whatever you're doing, and then just post that photo and hashtag Skywalker Selfie, and make sure that you tag us at Skywalking Pod, or just post in our Facebook group, whatever you'd like. Yeah, like Patty Hammond just did one.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Got it. Okay.
Yay.
And thanks to the Chicken Friends for sending us this vintage material.
Yeah, it's so cool.
This may accidentally get lost.
Hey, what are you doing?
Oh, no, it's already lost.
No,
don't know where that material went. So if you've pre-ordered this, we'll need to cancel your order because I don't know where it went. It disappeared.
Sweetie,
what?
I don't know. It was here
a second ago, and now it's just gone, okay? don't look at me.
Give me this.
Give me it.
Give me it now. Already have some orders for these. Chickafent, let me know if
look,
you want
misdirection.
Some misdirection. No, stop it.
It's gone. I don't know where it is.
Give me those Star Wars sheets back. All right. Yay, Skywalkers.
Neverland on Alderaan. It was funny when Luke Skywalker had mentioned Alderaan in the Muppet Show. Remember Alderaan.
Yeah. And you're like, wait, Neverland on Alderaan. Luke, you're saying it wrong.
You're not going to cut into this vintage fabric. No.
No.
It's already gone. We're already drinking.
We're already drinking.